Okay, with that, I would like to welcome our President and Chief Executive Officer of the U.S.-Japan Council, Suzanne Basala, to make welcome remarks. I'm sorry, Suzanne, we can't seem to hear you.
I'm sorry, one moment.
Great, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you now, thank you.
All right, super. And of course, they just started cutting a tree literally right outside, so I hope it's not too loud. Anyway, thank you all for being here. I really want to particularly thank the speakers who are coming here to share their stories with us and help us all learn. Also really grateful for the facilitators who are taking the time to put help with this. But really, I'm also so grateful to all of you who are choosing to be here to participate, giving up your Saturday or your Friday night. And I just see a lot of interesting people. And I'm back at USJC after being gone for a couple years. And I just want to, I see a couple old friends. I see Fuka and Pisil out there. And I'm really glad to see you still involved in Tomodachi and being part of this conversation. So I just thank you also, not just for your time, but for making yourselves open and vulnerable and being committed and having the courage to be part of this conversation. I personally have a very strong commitment to diversity and inclusion. I've done a lot of work in it in my career, but I don't have any experience and a knowledge to bring to the issues of Black communities. So I'm here along with you to learn and to grow. So I also appreciate you letting me be part of this conversation. A big part of what I want to do right now is introduce Karen Kelly, who will be making some welcome remarks and opening remarks. And it's a real privilege for us to have Karen here with us. Karen is the Consul General for Osaka and Kobe. And she's been in that position for over 3 years, and it's not been an easy 3 years, I'm sure. And what that means is that Karen is the senior representative of the US government for the Osaka and Kobe area. And she is taking care of all the aspects of American interests in Japan and supporting the US-Japan relationship in that region. She's also responsible for helping so many people in Japan who want to get to the United States and deal with issues with the United States, and looking out for the interests and protecting all of the Americans in that region. So we're so grateful for her service. Karen has spent her entire career serving the United States as a Foreign Service officer and been to many locations. I don't know if she's going to talk about it, but most recently she was in Zimbabwe, which must have been a really interesting experience. For me, it's really wonderful to have Karen here because Karen and I served together when I was in the embassy, and she was also in the embassy from 2010 to 2013 were the years that Karen was at the embassy. And she was in charge, she was the press attaché and spokesperson. So she was the face and the voice representing the US government to Japan. And she did this job, including on March 11th, 2011, and the triple disaster, the earthquake, tsunami, and the nuclear disaster. That's when Karen and I had a chance to work closely together. And so I know from working with her how resilient she is, how strong she is, and also how committed she is to the next generation and being part of starting the Tomodachi Initiative. Karen, when she was at the embassy, I was thinking about this, and Karen, you probably won't remember because you probably have to do this at all your embassies every year. But I do remember that during Black History Month, or maybe it was Martin Luther King Day, you gave a talk to the embassy staff about, I might be wrong, but I think it was about Black servicemen who served in the Revolutionary War. And I just remember it was this part of American history that I'd never heard about before. And I was really, really appreciative of learning that. But now in the moment and thinking about Black lives in the way that we've been asked to challenge ourselves, I realize we should have been teaching that to ourselves instead of asking you to be the one to teach that to us and represent. So I am actually just reflecting, even having you as part of this, already thinking about what was your experience like in the embassy and how could I have been a better colleague to you. So I'm actually just really here to learn, and I'm grateful for you to be here from us and look forward to your welcoming remarks. Thank you.
Good morning, afternoon, evening, wherever you are. I'm in Osaka, so it is morning here, and very pleased to have this opportunity to greet you all and to be a part of this discussion program. I would like to thank the U.S.-Japan Council and President and CEO Suzanne Basala for that kind introduction and for the invitation to join you today. As Suzanne noted, I have served as an American diplomat for more than 30 years now. I'm dating myself, but I don't care. 15 of those years have been in service in Japan at different times in my career. My very first diplomatic assignment was in Tokyo, and that is now over 30 years ago. And periodically during my assignment, my career, I've had an opportunity to return to Japan on different occasions. And in fact, this is the fourth assignment that I've had in Japan with a composite 15 years of service in Japan alone. I've served in other places, most notably in Africa, in Cameroon, and in Zimbabwe, in Southern Africa, Cameroon in West Africa, and also in the Philippines, in addition to having domestic service. Everywhere that I have been, it has been interesting to note the response to me as an American diplomat, but also as an African American serving the US government. And I have to say, in Japan, the reaction that I have engendered when people meet me has been very different from the realization of some people in the United States. In Japan, you are who you are introduced as. You are your calling card. You are your meishi. And I've handed my meishi to many people, and they've looked and they've seen, you know, U.S. embassy or U.S. consulate, and whatever title that I have been given during that assignment. And people accept that by and large as that's who you are. Which is interesting because in the United States, I've introduced myself and people say, oh, what kind of work are you doing? And I've said, oh, you know, I work for the State Department. I'm a diplomat. And the reaction is sometimes a little different. There's a little bit of incredulity. There's a little bit of questioning. And there is, I don't know, a mixed feeling. I raise that because I find it interesting because the Black Lives Matter movement, I think has had a similar reaction, if you will. But anyway, it has been, and I will get to that, but it's been a real privilege for me to represent the United States government and the American people in my service in Tokyo, Osaka, and I've also served in Okinawa, which are very interesting experiences, and I appreciate all of the contact that I've had over the years in Japan and with Japanese people. This is an incredibly tumultuous time in the United States with the worldwide coronavirus pandemic and its impact on communities across the United States, including on communities of color in the United States as well. But there's also the especially tragic instances of police violence against communities of color and the deaths of African Americans, most recently Breonna Taylor in Kentucky and George Floyd in Minneapolis, Minnesota, among others. And these instances, most recently, George Floyd's death has sparked protests across the country, and not only across the United States, but also across the world, where the media has focused on what's going on in the United States. And in particular, they focused on the protests that have turned in part to looting and destruction of property. And in some instances, frankly, the media attention on the protests has been more intent on looking at the destruction of property than the destruction of lives. And that is an interesting phenomenon as well. Some of the reporting has not been, in my view, very nuanced, because in the United States, there are questions in a lot of these instances as to who the instigators of the violence specifically and the destruction of property and the looting actually are. It's been attributed to Black Lives Matter, but I think there are a lot of serious questions as to who are the instigators of this kind of violence. There have also been supporting protests in Japan and around in cities around the in countries around the world, and that is also an interesting phenomenon as well. One of the roles of the U.S. mission in Japan and worldwide is to explain America, explain the U.S. government policies, and explain our institutions and our culture to audiences across the world. And so in an environment where these protests have been so attention grabbing, our role has shifted in part to explaining what is going on in the United States, which is a particularly challenging job for someone who has spent the entirety of this Black Lives Matter movement outside of the United States. So in a large part, although I am an American citizen, I am outside of the United States at this time, looking in like many others are looking in and taking in the events that are happening. We've had a number of programs here in Japan across our embassy and our consulates, five consulates across Japan, trying to have this dialogue with people to explain what is going on in the United States, what's going on in terms of the Black Lives Matter movement. And these discussions have been particularly interesting because especially among young people who are really surprised and curious, and I would say in some instances concerned about what's going on in the United States. Why the concern? What I've heard expressed is a sense of surprise and disappointment in the United States, a country that people in Japan have admired because of the ideals of freedom and equality and liberty. And to see the instances of violence against a group of people at the hands of authorities who are supposed to be devoted to protecting and serving has been surprising and disappointing in Japan as it has been in the United States. And I think that is one of the reasons why there have been protests of support in Japan as well, in Osaka, in Tokyo, in Fukuoka, most notably. People have gathered and have walked in protest and in support of the Black Lives Matter movement. Now, there may be other reasons why, but the reason that has struck me the most is that there is this support for the ideals of the United States and a concern in holding up a mirror to America and saying in so many words, these are the ideals that you have promoted around the world. And these are the ideals that we have accepted and adopted as American, and we want to understand why in this particular case America is not living up to its ideals. I think this is a legitimate criticism for people around the world to have about the United States. And I'm heartened that young people, not only in countries around the world, but also young people in the United States, across our diversity and across our ethnicity, are standing up and saying, America, we hold you to your ideals. And we want the America represented by the Statue of Liberty, and not this America that we see currently as being oppressive to any group of people. And so I have had a very interesting time having these conversations with people, and I look forward to this conversation today. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you so very much, Karen. It was such a pleasure to have you here, and I really appreciate all of your insight towards this very important topic. Next, we'd like to go into group discussions, since we really wanted to create this peer-to-peer opportunity to have these discussions among US youth and Japanese youth. So we will be breaking up into 8 different group discussions. One will be in Japanese only, one will be bilingual, and the others will be in English. So Andrea will be breaking everyone in and pulling everyone into separate groups. So when you get in, you'll see your facilitators and your fellow group peers. And we do that now. Thank you. So we'll see you back here in about 15 minutes. Enjoy your time. Okay, great. Wonderful. So I hope you had a good time connecting with everyone in your group. We're going to be hearing next from our speaker, Juniper Alexander, who is the co-founder and organizer for the BLM Tokyo movement. Some of you may have seen, heard the news, or even been a part of the BLM Tokyo protests that took place in Shibuya last month. So we wanted to really bring her in and have a discussion about, you know, why this is this movement is able to come over to Japan and why it's so important. Our alumni, Ian Mason, also known as Ryo Yamakawa, is going to be moderating this fireside chat. So after this, we're gonna have a Q&A, and then we'll break out into discussion groups again. So now I'll turn it over to Ian and Juniper to have our fireside chat.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Kaoru. Just a brief introduction. My name is Ian Mason. My Japanese name is Yamakawa Ryo. Very nice to meet you guys. Thank you so much for taking the time off your Friday night, Saturday morning to join us today. In these times, I think it's very important that we ask the important questions regarding the Black Lives Matter movement. But there is one thing that I would like to start off with. I would also like to welcome back Ms. Karen Kelly, who will be participating in the question and answers session as well after. But essentially, what I would like to highlight is that I will be asking 4 main questions regarding the Black Lives Matter movement. However, it's very important to note that systematic racism and the whole structure of it cannot be categorized within these 4 questions. So I think it's very important that if possible, after the session, we can all reflect and do more research regarding this as well. So thank you so much for your participation in that. But again, enough about me. I'm not the center of your attention today. I would like to move forward to speak with Juniper. And so if Juniper could give us a brief introduction, how she became involved with BLM, how you led the BLM Tokyo movement in Japan, that would be great.
All right. So as far as how I became involved with BLM, well, the story is kind of nice. It was, I'll try to keep this brief. I was following one of my friends on Instagram, and she was stating how upset she was at the murder of George Floyd and how blatant it was and things like that. And so she left a story on Instagram at about 3 in the morning about how she was planning to go downtown to protest. And I didn't see this until like almost like after the next day, so I slept in. I decided to join her. And as you might know by now, that is Sierra Todd. She was the original founder and leader of our group here in Japan. And we started protesting at the Yoyogi Park and in Harajuku, which is areas that she mainly hangs around. We held up signs that, held up protest signs that described the murder in English and in Japanese. And we got a lot of attention from passerbys and things like that. And some Japanese people were curious as to what it was about. We were able to explain it to them in about as much Japanese as I could, because I didn't understand how to say words like jinshu sabetsu and things like that. I only knew like sabetsu, those simple words. And as we grew, I started to learn a bit more vocabulary. And still, it was easy to explain, but I still have to explain things in English because the language is too complicated. I can't really do it in Japanese. So after the initial mini protests we had, it was about 8 to 10 of us. We walked from Yoyogi all the way to Shibuya. And we ended at night in Shibuya, where we just stood around with signs there, just making ourselves known and making the murder of George Floyd known. Be like, hey, this is wrong. And this is things like that. People need to pay attention to it because it could possibly happen here in Japan. And then after that, we decided to hold a bigger march to show stronger solidarity with everybody back in America and be like, hey, there's African people around the world and there's people who are not African that support the movement as well to say this is wrong and it needs to be shut down. So we started off with a Facebook group, Black Lives Matter Tokyo. I did not join the Facebook group because I do not have Facebook. I try to limit my online presence as much as I can. So I just mainly just use Instagram and that's about it. And then, the group, we didn't expect it to grow to the magnitude that it did. It started off with just the 10 of us and then it grew to like 20 and then 50. And like in my head, I'm like, this probably won't even make it past like 50, 100 people max. That's what we were expecting. And then it just kept growing like 100, 200, 500, 1,000. And the numbers just kept multiplying all the way up to the 3,600, I think it is right now. And like this blew us out of the water. Like this like blew our expectations. We didn't ever expect this many people, especially non-African people, to stand up in the name of the movement, to stand up against white supremacy, to stand up against oppressive things that are made to class people and to keep them oppressed. So we got super organized this way because of our large pool, we were able to pull talent from different areas. We had artists, we had people who were able to do like web design. We had people who were able to help us set up the march with like the police, because you have to have we as foreigners cannot do this with so many people legally. We have to have a Japanese person like basically sponsor us. And basically what that person does is say like, if we do something like create violence or destruction, they're going to be held responsible for it. So it puts it not just on us, but on that person as well. But we were real careful about our language. We were real careful about what we say. We can't go around saying F the police and things like that, because that's not what we're here for. We're here to bring the notion of oppression and inequality. We want to make that known. Well, like we know that the police aren't nowhere near as much of a problem in Japan as they are in the United States. But, we still have to make these things known because people are curious and people want to know. So we want to make sure that the right information is passed. But that's basically how it all got started up until the day that that we performed the march. And it was, to me, it was a great success.
Sorry about that. Still getting used to Zoom and everything. Thank you so much for providing us an introduction as to how you initiated the Black Lives Matter Tokyo movement in Japan, as well as your connections with Black Lives Matter to begin with. Now, in terms of the questions, I did want to start off big, more of a world perspective, and then start to focus on US and Japan, and then finally focus on the culture in Japan. So from a world perspective, I think it's quite obvious that although sad, the death of George Floyd sparked a monumental and perhaps a different feeling towards Black Lives Matter. And you could see the global impact that this had because there were countries in France, Europe, wherever, who were all participating in protests altogether. And I wanted to ask, what were your thoughts or what did you feel felt a bit different about this one? And two-part question, I do apologize. The first part is the world perspective. The second part is, do you think that the US Black Lives Matter movement, as well as the Japan movement, are connected in any way? So if you could touch upon those two subjects, that'd be great.
Okay, so on a world perspective, I personally was shocked, you know, that so many people around the world stood up against this. You know, like in my head, because like when we look at history, it's as far as like African people's fight in America, it's always been just us by ourselves, you know, and up until like, you know, like when Asian people started coming in to America and they started standing side by side with us with the whole Yellow Peril movement, you know, when people of Chinese, Japanese, Filipino, you know, we were all standing together, the Black Panthers were all standing together fighting against the oppressive system, like, hey, this is wrong, and things like that. But, you know, up until then, like, I've always learned that, like, it's just been us by ourselves. And so when we're seeing people from a global perspective of other cultures and other nations standing up to us, it's like, okay, we're not alone, you know, and that's due in part to, like, social media, you know, where, like, people can see these things, like, raw footage without any type of political input. It's like, yes, the press is going to get their hands on these videos as well because it's open source, but they're going to put their own spin on it based on what they want you to believe. They're going to tell you the conservative view of it. They're going to tell you the liberal view of it. They're going to tell you the socialist communistic view of it, whichever, you know, and that influences your thinking. But to me, with social media like Twitter and things like that, you can see the footage raw, uncut, without any input, you know, so you're free to form your own ideas. And I think that's what happened with the rest of the world. When they saw the raw uncut footage and be like, oh wow, this is still going on. We thought America ended this like years ago, like they profess that they're all about equality, they profess it all about this, that, and the third. But now we see that they're still doing what they've always been doing and it really hasn't changed, you know? So I think that's how the world got involved. As far as the Black Lives Matter Tokyo and well, every Black Lives Matter, because there's a lot of us, not just Tokyo, there's also in Kansai area, there's also in Fukuoka too. As far as Black Lives Matter Japan being associated with Black Lives Matter US, as far as solidarity goes, I think that's pretty much how we are. Like, we're also trying to educate people as much as we can. Like, mm-hmm. it's almost like a re-education that we're doing here in the Asian continent, you know, because African people have been given like a bad rap due to like imperialism and colonization. You know, they tell, you know, all this misinformation about African people are bad. African people do this, that, and the third. We're thieves, we're lazy. You know, all of these negative stereotypes that they projected in America have been brought worldwide. And, now it's kind of like we have to re-educate everyone and like, hey, we're not really like this. Here's the story. Here's how we ended up the way we are. I mean, not to be, you know, not to be petty or anything like that, but like, I don't consider grabbing somebody from another country and then making them build up your country and they're lazy. I don't think that's called laziness, you know. That's just my take on that part. But the fact that we're here to educate, whereas the people in the US are on the front lines, it's just more of a way to get more people on our side to help the movement and push it forward, you know, and maybe create some international pressure on the US government. You know, maybe it'll help change their mind. But for some reason, as the months have progressed, we're not really seeing that change.
Thank you so much for your feedback on that. You touched upon a very important aspect, I think, when it comes to learning more about these movements, and that is the education part and getting educated being selfless and, you know, trying to educate yourself, I wanted to ask, did you have any particular resources to help educate this movement accurately in Japan? Because I think what we saw was the NHK segment that tried to, you know, explain the situation of what's going on, but completely disregarded the main points. So did you have any important resources that we could access, or that you had suggestion for us, that we can kind of learn more about the accurate of what's going on in the United States with George Floyd?
Yes. I'm gonna have to like maybe pull out my camera for this to get it, because
yeah, of course.
Right. But so with the NHK segment, although it was very outrageous and very a complete and utter 100% miss, I also found it hilarious too, because it made me think, like, where did you get this information? Images of Black people, you know, like, you know, like you got the stereotypical big swole Black guy with a tank top on, and there's somebody with a boom box in the background, and he's just yelling at white people. And I'm like, well, when, where, and why? We don't do that. You know, you know, like this is the 1990s, the 1980s, like some gangster movie or something that they think that, you know, and I think that's where a lot of it comes from. It's from a lot of negative press and a lot of negative media, and are like, oh, this is what we see, so this must be what it is. I'm like, I'm sorry, that's a movie, that's fiction. You know, there is a level of truth behind it, but majority of it is fiction. Don't pull your sources from movies like that. Don't pull your sources from movies, period, unless it's like a documentary and it's backed up with sources and facts. You know, I would really be hard pressed to say that like NHK did any valuable research, or maybe even asked an African American person who could speak Japanese what the situation is. I really don't think that's how they got what they got. But as far as information that you can use to better educate yourself, you're gonna have to like pull things that were written in the past in order to understand the present. So one thing that you can read is this book called Policing Black Bodies, written by Angela J. Mathry. And basically it's about how the police are used to keep us incarcerated and keep us and keep the system of oppression going. And and ultimately it fuels capitalism, because you have to have poor people, you have to have oppressed people in order for capitalism to work. Otherwise it turns on its head. And then you have the book, where is it? Stamped from the Beginning, written by Ibram X. Kendi. And it's basically about the racist ideals in America, and like how they fuel the American thought and American economy today, and the system. And then you have, hold on. Like there's tons of books to read. Like I would have to like give you guys the printed out list that I gave you up before. But basically like the best way to learn history in this case is learning it from people who have studied this deeply. Make sure that they cite their sources, and you can fact check those sources too. You know, don't just go by what they say. If like your favorite news sources like Fox News or MSNBC or something like that, their news is going to be left-leaning or right-leaning depending on who you're listening to. You might have to check that.
Of course. Thank you so much. So again, in regards to some of the resources, we will try to follow up with our participants as to what kind of resources they can reach out to learn more about this. So more details to come. Now, I do apologize again, time constraints. I only have 5 minutes left for this question portion. So I do want to ask the last question for the Q&A session, which is in regards to the end goal of Black Lives Matter. What do you, excuse me, what do you feel is the end goal of this whole Black Lives Matter movement within Tokyo, or just in general? And do you think this movement will ever reach that point of meeting these goals in our lifetime, at least? I just feel that, you know, historically, you know, this is nothing new. African Americans, Black people have been dealing with this for however many years, more than 400, 300, wherever you want to start. But is there an end goal, or do you feel that there's an end goal And if there is one, what does that look like to you in your thoughts?
All right. So the end goal, as far as like America goes, is to obviously get to the point to where Black people are no longer being discriminated against. And in turn, that will basically have to eliminate the class system that's currently in America at the moment. You know, because like I said, like the American economy, the American government system has to rely on class. When people say the system is broken, that's not entirely accurate. It's more or less the system is performing as it's intended, mm-hmm. because it's how it's written from the beginning. When the forefathers wrote that all men are created equal back in 1775, when they were writing the Declaration of Independence, you also have to remember that these were the same people that were holding slaves at the same time. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't in one breath say all men are equal while you're telling a group of men, just because they don't look like you or don't come from the same land as you, that they're not equal or they're not men, you know, period. You know, so you got to look at history from that standpoint, and then the rest of it will just fall in place for you. You know, so the end goal is basically probably going to have to be the abolishment of the current system, or, you know, unless they find a way to like make what happened, what they have now work without the classism. As far as Japan goes, the end goal for Black Lives Matter Japan is basically it's just re-educating and helping Japanese people to apply critical thinking to situations. You know, don't just agree with something just because you see it from a quote unquote source of authority. You know, feel free to ask questions. Don't just take everything at face value. You know, and with doing that, you'll be able to question like, hey, are African people really like this? And then you look at other foreigners and be like, hey, are Middle Eastern people really like this? Or is this just propaganda? You know, all of this will start falling into place, and then you'll start thinking about your own culture. It's like, are we really like this? You know, what is the values of Japan? What are Japanese values? Does this sound, was what we're doing now in line with those values? So basically, I guess it's more of a personal goal for me. It's just to encourage thought, encourage critical thinking, you know, ask questions. Don't just settle for what you've been told. Can't hear you, Ethan. Did you mute your headphones by accident?
Okay, thank you so much, Juniper and Ian. While we wait for Ian to reconnect, I just want to say thanks again to Juniper for sharing your experiences. And this is a really important movement. I'm glad that we're able to have this discussion. Next, we'll be moving into the Q&A section. So we'd like to invite Consul General Kelly back into the discussion. And if you would like to put in your questions into the chat, it is now open for everyone to send your questions. So please do that towards Ian, Juniper, and Karen Kelly. So we'll wait for you to send in those questions. And in the meantime, check to make sure that Ian is back.
Yes, I'm so sorry about that, guys. Sorry, technical difficulties, still getting used to Zoom, double screening, everything. My apologies. Thank you so much for your patience.
Yeah, so passing it back to you, Ian. Thank you.
Great. Yes. So, yes, if you could send questions. Now, again, I do apologize, but as there are 58 participants, I can only delve upon a couple of questions. But we will keep a record of those questions in our session, and so hopefully we can touch upon them in a future session. Or in a reply as soon as possible. So thank you so much for you guys' understanding. Let me just see here.
And we also have questions that we've received from all of you when you registered, and we have that list with us as well, so we can always pull from there as well.
So how to just make sure I'm receiving the chats, correct?
Ian, do you want to pull from the questions that we received from the registration? You're on mute, Ian.
Sorry, I actually just received a question from one of the participants. So would you mind if I just go over that one, the questions, and then we can delve upon the other ones? Would that be okay? Great.
I didn't see me, but my thumbs are up. Go ahead.
Okay, sorry about that. Yeah, sorry. Yes, so the first question is to Juniper from Kintara Morrison, Washington, D.C. How are the Black Lives Matter Tokyo protests being received by the general public in Japan? Which is, again, a very good question, something I wanted to touch upon, but I couldn't. But I wanted to ask Juniper what your thoughts on that were.
So I've been keeping up with a couple of news outlets after our immediately after our protest, and a lot of the as I expected, a lot of the right wing leaning people were against our protest, saying, "Why are you doing this? This is an American only issue." Even people claiming like you're not social distancing, you're promoting the spread of coronavirus and things like that. You know, we're being attacked by all type of things like this. So to address that first concern, like, no, actually, this is not just an American issue. This is also an issue here in Japan, which is why we decided to do the march as well. No, we do not face the level of police brutality nowhere near what we face in America. But we do face, but especially African men, you know, they face racial profiling from the police officers, especially when in the Roppongi area, because there's a high population of African people. And they're usually stopped to see if they have drugs or something like that. It's basically pop and stop, like they're trying to play the lottery and say, "Oh, we caught somebody finally with drugs." You know, there's other issues too, along with cultural appropriation and the fact that Japanese people perform blackface regularly and don't understand why we are upset at that, which again goes into studying the history of all the history of why we think it's oppressive. That goes back to minstrel shows. And the movie Birth of a Nation, you know, it's a trigger warning. If you watch Birth of a Nation, you're going to see a lot of triggering things. There's a lot of homophobia, transphobia, racism, all of that stuff's in Birth of a Nation. It's all just it was all just an early promotion of white supremacy, pretty much. That's what it was.
Thank you so much. Sorry, I cut you off. Was there anything else that you wanted to add?
I was gonna say, and then you have the socialist communist party who supported our movement, saying this is good. You're drawing attention to issues in Japan that we've been trying to draw attention to. You know, there's people who's for us and there's people who are against us. So, you know, it's a mixed bag, but I think majority of the opinion is more towards the right leaning side, conservative people.
Great. Thank you so much for that question. Moving forward, because I do want to get through as many questions as possible, because I'm just receiving left and right. My next question is actually a question to Ms. Karen Kelly. Thank you so much for participation in the program today, as well as the Q&A session. We have a participant who would like to know what your general thoughts on how the Japanese media is portraying Black Lives Matter, and any sort of feedback you may have in regards to this topic as well.
Thank you. What I have seen of Japanese media reporting has been focused on the protests in the United States and strict kind of reporting of what's going on. The focus of the reporting has, of course, been on some of the incidents of destruction of property and looting. That is kind of the nature of media. You take the most sensational elements and you focus on that. So to some extent, the reporting has focused on oh, these areas are being burned or these shops are being looted and that's Black Lives Matter. And so to the extent that looting and burning is now equivalent to the Black Lives Matter protest, it skews the view of the public that's receiving that information. And, you know, for a lot of Japanese, you know, who have traveled to some of these places, it's shocking to see, you know, oh, I was there that summer, or I did my homestay in this city, or I went to that university, and, you know, these iconic areas of my impressions of the United States are being looted and burned, and, and in the name of Black Lives Matter. So it gives a skewed impression of what's going on when they don't delve into the reasons why. And for the Japanese media especially, it's inexcusable, because I know that of all of the global media in the United States, Japan has a substantial media presence in the United States. So they can afford to talk to people. They have bureaus around the country. So to have these stereotyped and stilted images of the Black Lives Matter movement, they had to ignore a lot of the resources that they have in the United States in order to come up with these stereotypical images of what's going on in the US. Pick another country, a third world country, if you will, that does not have overseas reporters. And if they came up with the kind of reporting that some of Japan's media has done, I could understand it, because they don't have people in the United States. But it's inexcusable for a country like Japan that has so much presence in the United States not to choose to interview anyone who could tell them what the protests are about. There is no reason why, possessing the resources that they have in the United States to settle for this really kind of very inadequate reporting to the Japanese people.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your feedback. Yes, I wholeheartedly agree with that as well. And it's very good. And thank you very much for touching upon the NHK segment and how that pertains to Japanese media. There are a couple questions regarding that, and you were able to answer that. So thank you very much for that. I'm just going to go through the list of questions. Thank you so much again. I'd like to cover all 58 questions. I'm just going to go through the list to see here. Double screening. Let's see. Yes, I do have a question, and this is to anyone, so open. It says that many of the important leaders from the civil rights movement were either killed or assassinated before the full scope of their work could be completed. How can we bring up new leaders for the modern era while protecting their safety, ensuring that there is long-lasting change? And that's open to anyone, a very specific and I think a very important question to raise in this climate as well. So did Karen or Juniper, did you want to touch upon that question as well, if possible?
Yeah, I'm happy to take a stab at that question, and thank you for the
thank
question.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
The protest against the status quo in America or in any other country will generally meet with resistance by the status quo. And sometimes that resistance, in the instance of the civil rights movement, becomes violent, and leaders are attacked. And there has been, in the Black Lives Matter movement, there have been some reports of people being targeted, and and that is very much in keeping with the history of resistance in the United States. And so how do you protect leaders? I think what I find encouraging is that so many Americans who are not African American or Black Americans or Brown Americans, but Americans across the board are a part of the protests. And I think that, you know, it makes it harder to target specific individuals when you have what is a grassroots movement and people are standing up in their communities and saying that things have to get better, things must change, we must be more inclusive in this society. Designating someone as a leader is, by the very definition, putting a target on their back. So the way to prevent that is for all of us to stand up and say, this matters to me, and this matters in my community. It matters that my community is inclusive. It matters that my family is inclusive. And some of the hardest conversations are not among Black Lives Matter or African American people and the non-Black population, but it's those conversations that are happening over the dinner table in white homes, among, you know, the neighbors who people suddenly discover that their neighbors are flying Confederate flags and are triggered by the statement Black Lives Matter. And it is that discovery that that my quiet, picturesque suburban neighborhood now harbors people who I never realized have these hateful views and have these racist and discriminatory views. When those conversations happen, it doesn't matter that Black people live or not live in these communities or are a part of these conversations. What matters is that these conversations are now happening. And I think when it becomes an American issue and not a hyphenated American issue, then we will see that there will be progress. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, Ms. Karen. I think one of the points that I wholeheartedly agree with and I think really resonated with me is that it's important to not set one person as a leader, but that if we all become leaders, that change could happen. So thank you very much on your thoughts on that. I wanted to ask Juniper, did you have any thoughts on this question? Just to make sure that we cover that as well.
Yes, I wholeheartedly agree with Ms. Karen Kelly said. You cannot designate somebody as a leader. That is, like she said, is a good way to get somebody targeted just for the kill. That's what they did with Martin Luther King. That's what they did with Malcolm X. You know, luckily Angela Davis, you know, she was a target of the FBI, but she's still alive today and she still is doing the talks. But in order, the way that I perceive to do this is to not designate a leader at all. You know, everybody has to have a stake and everybody has to have a claim in the fight against the oppression. It just so happens that Black Lives Matter is the catalyst for this, you know? So it can be anyone. It can be a white person. It can be a Native American person. It can be a Hispanic, it can be an Asian person, you know? Somebody has to get the wheel started. But everybody who participates has to act like they are a leader themselves. They have to take full responsibility and take full charge of and full investment in what they're in. That's how we prevent from having a targeted leader. Because when everybody acts like they're a leader, then they're not going to know who to target. You know? So it creates confusion amongst the enemy. It keeps everybody safe and it keeps the vehicle moving forward until we finally reach our end goal. So that's pretty much all I have to say about it.
Thank you so much. Again, thank you so much for highlighting the importance of how we all have to be leaders in this situation. So in terms of the time, again, I do apologize. We have time for one more last question, a short question, last 4 minutes. I'm just going through the list here. If you can give me one quick moment. Yes. I think it's a pretty important one. One of our participants would like to know, in terms of your thoughts on BLM, systematic racism, do you think that US and Japan school systems need to do more to teach about systematic racism in contemporary society as part of, say, social studies classes? And in your thoughts, obviously, you know, what does that look like to you? If you can kind of give us an idea on that. And that's to either party, Ms. Karen Kelly or Juniper.
Yeah, it's education is a part of it because racism is a learned response. Part of it is what is not taught. And then part of it is what is deliberately promoted. Having African American history start with a page or two in the history books about slavery and then jump to the civil rights movement and Martin Luther King and Rosa Parks on a bus and then move on that is the totality of the African experience in the New World leaves the impression that, you know, there were slaves and that was bad, but there was the civil rights movement and now it's over. And whatever problems Black people have, you know, it's their own problem and they just need to get with the American program and pull themselves up by their bootstraps and everything will be all right. And that really glosses over a lot of American history and a lot of contemporary reality. So yes, education is really important, and a more inclusive education and a more inclusive history of the United States would include the contributions of not only African-Americans, the reality of the Asian experience in the United States, the reality of the Hispanic experience in the United States, and all of these elements that have contributed to what America is and what it isn't today, contemporarily. Finally, I just would just say quickly that, you know, the long-term goal is to create a society where it is hard to use the elements of society to oppress a group of people. But we are not going to change what is in the hearts and minds of people. Until we get some special ray gun that we can point at somebody and kind of identify the racism and blot it out. What people harbor in their hearts is beyond our control. And what parents teach their children in the quiet of their and the privacy of their homes is beyond our control. What we can control are the systems that a society puts together and creates in order to advantage one group of people and disadvantage other groups of people. And that is what the effort to dismantle systemic racism is about. But even if we take it all apart and put it together in a way that advantages each of us equally, that will not prevent people from hating the people that do not look like them. That is an objective that is beyond the human experience to control right now.
Thank you very much, Ms. Karen Kelly. And I do apologize again, due to time constraints, that's gonna be the last question that we will be covering today. Again, thank you very much for everyone's questions. And my apologies that I couldn't get to all your questions. I think that we will take a 5-minute break before going into the second part of the discussion group. So perhaps if you could keep those questions and bring it up during your discussion groups, the facilitators may be able to kind of touch upon your thoughts as well. So thank you very much. And thank you so much for both Juniper and Ms. Karen Kelly for participating in the Q&A session, as well as the overall fireside chat. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you very much to both Ian, Juniper, and Ms. Karen Kelly for joining us for the Q&A sections. And thank you to all of you who sent in your questions. As Ian said, I'm sorry we couldn't get to all of them, but these are very important questions and we hope to continue the discussion within the breakouts. So now we're going into a quick 5-minute break. So please come back. Right now it is 11:23. Okay. So we'll come back in 5 minutes at 11:28 Japan time. Please log in a little bit earlier so we have time to break you into your discussion groups. All right. Okay, think we're getting everyone back. I see the video slowly turning on. I hope you had enough time to grab some water or take a quick bathroom break. Next, we'll be breaking into our discussion groups again, and we'll be doing a deeper dive into what we've just heard from the speakers. You will have 25 minutes for this group discussion, and your lovely facilitators will be helping with that dialogue. Whenever you're ready, Andrea, could we put people into these discussion groups? Thank you. Okay, so welcome back. I think we have everyone back now. I hope you had some really great discussions. As I mentioned in the very beginning, this is, you know, a safe space. The discussion groups are closed, not recorded. But if you would like to share anything that you discussed within your small groups to everyone else here, we would love to hear from you since, you know, we can't all be in each other's groups. But if you'd like to share, especially how your idea of the Black Lives Matter movement has changed after joining this discussion today. And feel free to raise your hand and Andrea can unmute you. Okay, I'm getting a hand raised from Kai.
Hi. Hi, I'm Kai. I'm from Ann Arbor, Michigan. Something that I've been talking about, especially as a half Black mixed Japanese person, is just the perception of foreigners or people who don't look Japanese in Japan. And I think something that happens a lot is, well, in my group, I was talking about how there's this concept of junjapa, which means like, if you look Japanese, then people kind of assume that you're Japanese, or like you kind of have to be 100% Japanese for people to treat you like a Japanese person. And that's something that my brother and I have faced throughout our whole lives in Japan and in America. And especially being Black, I think that's amplified for us because people are really, really surprised when I speak in Japanese or when I tell them I understand Japanese culture, that I've been in Japan for however long. And I think that's kind of a concept or an idea that has to change, is that, you know, people have to look Japanese to be Japanese, or that people have to look or act or think a certain way to be accepted into Japanese society. And I think that's something that's being challenged right now with people like Naomi Osaka and just like more apparent people who are both Japanese and Black and who kind of exist at that intersection. But I don't think it's nearly enough work. And I think there has to be more done to promote this idea that there are Black people who are Japanese and there are Japanese people who are Black. And that's one of the many reasons why it's so important for Japanese people to care about Black Lives Matter, because we're not just a separate race. You know, Japan isn't just this homogenous monolith. You know, like there are people who are different here who are very much a part of the culture and who should very much be accepted into the society. And I think that's just, yeah, one of the huge reasons why I think Black Lives Matter in Japan too.
Great, thanks so much for sharing that, Kai. Next, I saw a hand raised from Kota. Kota Kondo.
Yeah, actually, I studied at Michigan, Ann Arbor, actually. So, okay. so thank you so much for this opportunity. As a Japanese, I was born and raised here, so I have never thought about like my race really seriously. And then this is great opportunity because. And also what struck me a lot is Juniper said that, you know, end goal of this BLM movement in Japan is changing education. And then, you know, we've never been taught like racism in Japan, not really seriously. And then we have never questioned what we have taught, you know, your teachers give you some answers that you have to memorize, you have to put it down on exam. That's it. You've never questioned what they teach. So changing education is I think it would be really tough, but I know that's the goal of like BLM movement in Japan, and that's blowing my mind. I do want to do something for that purpose. I love that idea, and not just for racism, but it is kind of taboo to talk about, political issues in Japan, but you have to change all of this matter, and then I want to be a part of it. So thank you so much for this great opportunity. I really appreciated it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kota. Next, we'd like to hear from Danielle.
Hi, everyone. I'm Danny. I'm from Los Angeles. I think something that we have been talking about a lot in the United States is more so how we have to see BLM as not an issue that we merely empathize with, but instead one that we take on as our own. And I mean, we can dive deeper into it being more like a white framework. White people need to begin seeing Black issues as their own, because they are a main part of how we reach ultimately liberation. And I think it was really helpful hearing Karen and Juniper talk about forms of leadership within this movement. I am not Black. I am a person of color, but when it comes to amplifying Black voices, you must be intentional with not co-opting the movement. While we do have collective liberation in that, I am still not a Black person, and I will not intentionally take away space from Black experiences because I am not targeted by police brutality. So I think it was helpful to hear that you can be a leader and you can provide your own acts of resistance to whatever capacity you can, whether that's in your hometown. I'm in LA, so there are a lot of really large protests happening often. But in the section of LA that I live in, these aren't really conversations that are being had, but using the framework of BLM and staying informed with their objectives, it is our part to amplify those voices and bring them to wherever our home might be.
Great, thanks so much. And I'm sorry we're going a little over time. This is such great conversation that if it's okay with everybody, I'd like to just take a few more minutes. If you need to log off, please do, we understand. But if you can stay, I'd just like to hear from maybe two more people who'd like to share their discussions or their thoughts from today. Oh, Michelle.
Okay, so I've talked in my group also, and I think that in compare of United States, in Japan, it's the people, especially the young generation, they are not much free to talk their opinions and raise their voice. So I think that these kind of issues, we in Japan also the people should take more familiar to their so to talk about these kind of issues. So for that, I think the just like these kind of talk sessions, we should more open to all youngster of Japan, so they take these kind of issues to their own, so they get more familiar. And yeah, I would like to talk about these to my friends also and other young generation of Japan. Yeah.
Great, thank you so very much. Let's see, one last person, but I think I see like a few hands up, really hard to choose. Felix, would you like to be our last person to share?
Sure, thank you. And thank you so much for this event. I think this is a really wonderful conversation. One of the things that I thought was really great that sort of came out of our discussion was how is the BLM movement relevant to Japan? And from that, a sort of there was discussion about how it can sort of, in a sense, sort of serve as a model for other movements for marginalized groups within Japan or anywhere else around the world. And from what I know about history, you know, the civil rights movement here in America served as a model for example, the women's rights movements, the LGBT rights movements, the Chicano movement. And so it could work sort of similarly in Japan for marginalized groups like the Buraku, the Ainu, the Ryukyu people, the Zainichi as well, you know, any sort of, and also the women's movement as well in Japan. And yeah, I think that's really an important thing to highlight how it's important to everyone.
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you for that comment. I'd also like to ask next Juniper if I could get a few words, closing remarks from her. And Karen, if that's okay, I'd like to ask you if you could share your thoughts too.
Okay, so I guess closing remarks. I'd like to thank everybody who attended and everybody who came together, put this together first of all, and then I would like to thank everybody who came here to listen and to learn. This is the first step in creating change for wherever you are in the world. You know, maybe you see some type of inequality or something like that where you live, you know, maybe not necessarily in Japan, maybe in another part of the world that you visit, or you might have family in or something like that. You know, like the young man, I think it was Bishal, who said that, you know, it's a taboo talking point in Japan to talk about politics and things like that, you know. And like, it takes a certain level of bravery to be able to stand up against taboo topics. It's like, because I guess because of the way I'm thinking, the way I think, the way I've been taught to think, because I'm 9 years in the military. I've done martial arts since I was like 8 years old. So I have a very headstrong yet disciplined way of viewing things. And the one thing is that I like to tell people is that, is it going to put you in jail pretty much? It's like, it's taboo, yes, but is it against the law? Is it going to put you in jail? And even if so, question why it puts you in jail. Question why does it have that oppression level to it? Because it probably has a reason for that. And then you, once you find out that reason, you can then therefore justify your action. But like, oh, you're keeping my voice suppressed because if X people rise up against you, then you feel you're going to lose power. You feel like you're going to lose something if the common people stand up against you, you know, and that's not right. You know, common people should have a voice just as loud or even louder than the powerful, you know. So my thing is like, don't be afraid to be a leader, you know, have that talk with your friends. Don't be afraid to stand up at the dinner table and be like, no, I'm sorry, auntie, I know you were born in the 50s, but like that viewpoint is, it's old fashioned. It's not acceptable in this day and age. You don't know anything about these people. You know, you only go by what you were told, but you never lived their life, things like that. You know, try to gather sources of information. Make sure they're coming from the correct sources too, because there's even other African people who get the information wrong, or they're trying to push a different agenda. Maybe because, you know, that goes into asking why. Why are you going against what other African people say? Like, are you trying to push the agenda of white supremacy? And if so, what's in it for you? Are you gaining something from this? Are they using you as a puppet, figurehead? A lot of people like to say, you know, like things about our last president, you know, like Obama was this, that, and the third. Like, yes, he had good points. He also had bad points, you know. So it's just like with anybody, any type of leadership position, you can learn from their good and their bad. You know, just discard the bad things and just run with the good and move on with your life. So those are pretty much my closing words. Sorry, I can't provide more for you because time and things like that. But if you guys want to contact with me and talk more with me, I have an Instagram. It's midboss_June, J-U-N. And feel free to message me. I'm pretty open. You know, like there isn't much you can say that can offend me. Like I pretty much cut that part off of my life a long time ago. So hope to hear from you guys later and hope to do more webinars or e-meetings or maybe even meet you guys in person. All right.
Thank you, Jennifer. I really appreciate you being a part of this discussion and really kicking us off the right way. Next, I'd like to ask Karen Kelly to make some closing remarks.
Sure, thank you. I would just like to thank the US-Japan Council for creating a safe place where we can come together and start a conversation. Certainly this should not be the end of the conversation. And I think if there were people here who had doubting voices or opinions about the Black Lives Matter movement, I would encourage you at the next conversation to speak up. This should not be an echo chamber where everyone who feels the same or has the same opinion are the only people who speak. If you don't agree, and especially if you don't agree, you should feel that safe space means that your opinions are respected as well. So I look forward to the opportunity to continue these conversations and to look forward to a way to become a more inclusive community, not only within our respective countries, but across the world as well. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. And finally, I know we are a little over time, but I'd like to just share two things. One, I'm just launching a poll right now. I've gotten some comments that people might want to keep in touch with the groups and continue the discussion with their teams that they've had. I'm thinking of sharing your contact information with your facilitator, and perhaps your facilitator can reach out or connect your teams, or we can just share that contact information so that you can continue to keep in touch. So please select yes or no. And while you do that, I'll also share my screen. Here is, I know so many polls. Here is another QR code. If you could please scan it, you know, take your cell phone and scan it with your camera app. It'll direct you to a survey. We really want you to tell us how we did. This is a conversation that we want to continue having, and as everyone mentioned, you know, education is incredibly important and having a safe space is incredibly important. After this, we'll be sending you an email with the book list that Juniper mentioned earlier in the fireside chat. We'll also be sending you other resources. And we'd like to invite you to part two and part three that we'll be having later on. We don't have the dates for that yet, but part two will be focused on the Japanese American experience. And then part three will be focused on discrimination in Japan. So we really hope that you'll be able to join us for those discussions. As I believe it was Felix that said that this has really become kind of a catalyst, the kickoff, a model for other movements to really begin. And I hope that we can really continue this discussion and to have these really important mindset shifts take place. I would love for everyone to become a real upstander, not just a bystander, but really stand up for what you believe in, for what you think society should be treating people equally and fairly. And so thank you again for joining us. And I hope you have a lovely, for those in Japan, I hope you have a lovely weekend. And for those in the States, thank you very much for staying up late with us. Please continue to be a part of this journey with us. Thank you.